never thought I could make a living as a writer. I thought doing so successfully was a privilege, one only afforded to a select best-selling few. I relegated writing to a mere hobby and nothing more. If I obsessed over characters and plots and fictional relationships, that just meant I had a hyperactive imagination, not necessarily an innate talent. It certainly didn't mean that I could be a writer when I grew up. Even after I had my first novel published when I was 15, a novel I look back at with pure embarrassment, as most would with their, you know, teenage thoughts, I was never under any illusions. The first authors whose books I devoured were overwhelmingly white, and like a good Bengali girl in East London, I wanted to please my parents by opting for a law degree. Mistake, by the way. I was lucky in a lot of ways. I got good grades, though that came at the price of my sanity and my well-being, as anyone with Asian parents would tell you. It was drilled into me that I have to work three times as hard to be half as good, and I took that seriously, so seriously that when I was doing my A-levels, I didn't do any writing. And when I did get back into writing, it was with hesitation in my heart because I really should have been reading up on the countless cases I had to learn at law school. To this day, I remember only the cases that had compelling or interesting stories. The woman who sued after finding a dead snail in her ginger beer. True story. The shipwrecked prisoners who drew lots to decide who among them on the boat should be eaten.
Wow.
The conjoined twins whose parents opposed the separation necessary for one twin to live. Truthfully, I could write about them all day, especially what happened next. But the law isn't always interested in the granular literary details. And from reading the judgments, I didn't get a sense of the prisoners' desperation or hopelessness when they could think of no alternative to their survival than taking another life, nor the fear in the boy who was killed and then eaten. The emotions felt were less important than the outcome. In this case, if there was ever a legal defense for murder through necessity, which sounds much more boring. The questions I had about the people in the case were lost, buried in legal theory that could put me to sleep, a mean feat considering that I struggled with insomnia most of my time in university. So it's not a surprise looking back that I ended up not pursuing a legal career. What did surprise me was that every time I faltered or wondered if I'd made a mistake, something always brought me back to writing. When I did my law degree, the modules on writing and literature kept me going. When I struggled to verbally express my emotions, including a lot of the anger at the broken world around me, writing them down works wonders. But what has also helped personally is what happens after I write something. Where some publications may have flinched at my anti-capitalist stance or politicised my identity, the folks at Lumpen have never wavered with my story. They have done a wonderful job with editing my work, and seeing it in print made my year. Again, not an easy thing given it was 2021. If writing my story soothed my rotten heart, then having it published, being validated, is what helped me heal. By giving me the platform to tell my story, I felt heard, and it's given me the confidence to pitch more stories that have gone on to be in other publications. As for what's next, beyond a few stories in the pipeline, I don't know, but what I do know is that writing for me is like gravity. I might not even realise or sense it, but I'm always going to be pulled in the direction of words, and much like gravity, I want my words to continue to be a force of nature. Also, sorry, I just realised I didn't do the audio thing. Yeah.